Okay, so in this video, what we are going to do is define Cauchy sequences and talk about the relationship between Cauchy sequences and convergent sequences. Okay, so it turns out that in the set of reals, Cauchy sequences are the same as convergent sequences. And what it turns out this gives us is an alternative way of essentially establishing the convergence of a sequence. Okay, so let me write the definition down and then we can talk about what it means. Okay, so this is the definition of a Cauchy sequence. A sequence is Cauchy if for any epsilon greater than 0, there exists some threshold capital N such that any two entries of the sequence to the right of position number capital N are within epsilon of one another. Okay, so a sequence is Cauchy if no matter how small an epsilon positive that you pick, there exists a certain threshold, which we are denoting by capital N, such that the entries of the sequence to the right of that threshold are within epsilon distance of one another, right? So essentially, a sequence is Cauchy if the entries of the sequence are basically progressively becoming closer to one another. Okay, so I hope that intuition is clear. The fact that the entries are getting progressively closer is captured by exactly this condition that no matter what positive epsilon you pick, there's a certain threshold beyond which the entries become within epsilon distance of one another, right? Now you should expect, therefore, that the notion of a Cauchy sequence is related to the notion of a convergent sequence, because in the case of a convergent sequence, the entries of the sequence are becoming progressively and arbitrarily closer and closer to the limit value, right? On the other hand, here the entries of the sequence are becoming progressively and arbitrarily closer to one another, right? And it seems natural to expect that each of these implies the other, and that is indeed the case, that Cauchy sequences are convergent sequences. A sequence is Cauchy if and only if it is convergent. Okay, so this is in fact, this result gives us another way of establishing the convergence of a sequence without explicitly identifying the limit. Recall that in the original definition, to establish that a sequence converges, you had to identify the limit and show that the distance between the entries of the sequence and the limit that you have claimed becomes progressively and arbitrarily small. On the other hand, here, you just have to look at the entries of the sequence, compare them to one another, and point out that so long as they are getting closer and closer and closer to one another, the sequence is convergent. In other words, the limit exists, only you don't have to identify it in order to say that the sequence is convergent. Okay? There will be a few more things to say about the equivalence between Cauchy sequences and convergence sequences, but I'll talk about that after the proof itself. So this is an equivalence statement. So clearly there are two parts to the theorem. Let's say part one is where I want to prove that convergence implies Cauchy. Okay, this one is actually fairly straightforward. So suppose that xn tends to x, which is of course a real number, right? This follows that such an x exists is of course a consequence of the convergence of the sequence. Okay, now given any epsilon greater than 0, there exists an n naught such that xn minus x is in fact less than epsilon by 2 for all n greater than n naught. Yeah, so for whatever epsilon you give me, I am choosing the threshold n naught in such that the distance between the entries of the sequence and the limit is less than epsilon by 2 for all n greater than n naught. Right? Again, I want to re-emphasize this. It doesn't matter whether you say n greater than n naught or n greater than equal to n naught. These two are can be used interchangeably. If one holds, the other holds, and vice versa. Okay. Next, the fact that the entries of the sequence are within epsilon by 2 distance of the limit implies that they are within an epsilon distance of one another by the triangle inequality. That's the idea. So thus, for m and n greater than n naught, xm minus xn is in fact xm minus x plus xn minus x, minus right, which by triangle inequality is at most the sum of the individual absolute values. Each of these is less than epsilon by 2, so the whole thing is less than epsilon. That's it, right? So that means that we have demonstrated that no matter what epsilon you give me, I can give you a threshold n naught such that the entries of the sequence to the right of that threshold are within epsilon distance of one another. That proves by definition that the sequence is also Cauchy. Okay, this is part two now. Now we want to argue that Cauchy implies convergence. Now, all we have really to fall back on is, of course, just the definition of a Cauchy sequence. So, let's invoke that. Given epsilon greater than 0, there clearly exists some n naught such that for all m, n greater than n naught, that's just the definition of Cauchy. Now let us see how it is that I can leverage this. This means that if I fix the m, remember this was true for all m n greater than n naught, fix the m, you can fix it arbitrarily if you like. If you fix the m, it follows that xn should be sandwiched between xm minus epsilon and xm plus epsilon, right? And in particular, this is true for all n greater than n naught. this is just a restatement of that of the earlier result, right? That the fact that xm minus xn is less than epsilon implies that if I for the moment fix m, then xn should be sandwiched between xm plus epsilon and xm minus epsilon for all n greater than n naught. Okay? In other words, the entire tail of the sequence is sandwiched between xm plus epsilon and xm minus epsilon. Okay? So, from this, there are multiple conclusions I can make. The first of these is that if you look at the supremum of the entries of the sequence, right, every entry to the right of n naught is less than xm plus epsilon. Right? So, if I look at the supremum, it has to be less than or equal to xm plus epsilon. Right? Clearly, the existence of an upper bound is clear. Xm plus epsilon is an upper bound on the tail entries of the sequence to the right of n naught. Therefore, if I take the supremum which is the least upper bound would be less than or equal to xm plus epsilon. Okay, which also implies that if you look at the lim sup of the sequence, that is also less than or equal to xm plus epsilon. Okay, so I know that the lim sup is at most xm plus epsilon. Right, now similarly, I can make a claim about the lim inf. Right, so similarly, I'm going to skip a step here. I'm now going to just use the lower bound. That the fact that xm minus epsilon is less than the tail entries of the sequence means xm minus epsilon is less than equal to the infimum of xk such that k is greater than n naught. The fact that xm minus epsilon is a lower bound implies that it is less than or equal to the greatest lower bound. In other words, lim inf of xn is greater than or equal to xm minus epsilon. So now from these two parts, from 1 and 2, what you have is that lim sup of xn is less than or equal to lim inf of xn plus 2 times epsilon. Okay, and in particular, this inequality is true for any positive epsilon. Now, as we have talked about before, the fact that this is true for every positive epsilon implies that the lim sup of xn is less than or equal to the lim inf of xn. Right? And since the opposite inequality is true in any case, right? It is for any sequence, the lim sup is greater than or equal to the lim inf. Having established, therefore, that the lim sup is less than or equal to lim inf, that means that the lim sup has to be equal to the lim inf. Right, implies that the sequence converges. So not only do the lim sup and the lim inf agree, but in this case that the lim sup and the lim inf are, you know, they agree and they are real. Right? That implies that the sequence converges. So this is how you show that a Cauchy sequence is a convergent sequence. If you think about it, the argument is fairly straightforward. The fact that the entries of the sequence are close to one another implies that the supremum of the tail and the infimum of the tail cannot be too far apart, which imply that the lim sup and the lim inf cannot be too far apart, right? And since it's possible to say that the lim sup is at most the lim inf plus 2 epsilon, where epsilon is arbitrary, that in turn lets you conclude that the lim sup must necessarily be equal to the lim inf, right? That kind of is the crux of this argument. Now that we are done with this, that almost brings us to the end of this video. I want to emphasize one final thing. The first thing to note is that to prove that a convergent sequence is Cauchy was a trivial consequence of the definition of the notion of convergence in the first place. Okay, so it turns out that, you know, we aren't yet talking about the spaces more abstract than the reals. But even in abstract spaces, it turns out that the definition of convergence is such that to show that convergence implies Cauchy is very straightforward. Okay. On the other hand, if you look at how we proved that Cauchy implies convergence relies strongly on the least upper bound property in R. Okay, so it turns out that the notion of convergence and the notion of a Cauchy sequence can actually be defined in more abstract spaces than R, right? And if possible, we will try to give examples of this going forward. However, while convergence implies Cauchy somewhat universally, because just the definitions are such that the definition of convergence implies the definition of Cauchy. However, the converse is only true in a space where, well, the least upper bound property is not right, but you know, you need some equivalent of the least upper bound property. In other words, the converse is only true crucially because we have the least upper bound property on R. In other words, if I was to construct sequences using natural numbers, every convergent sequence of rational numbers is in fact Cauchy, but you cannot argue that every Cauchy sequence of rational numbers is in fact convergent, because you may not be able to identify a limit in the rationals which actually satisfies the definition of convergence. Right, so this will become clearer going forward, but the only thing to note very strongly is that the part where we are saying Cauchy implies convergence requires the least upper bound property. Remember, it is with the least upper bound property that I'm allowed to talk about soup of any set, inf of any set, and therefore the lim soup of a sequence and the lim inf of a sequence and the lim soup related to the lim inf in the manner that it does. All of that relies crucially on the least upper bound property, right? So crucially, it is this side of the equivalence, the Cauchy implies convergence part, which in fact relies on the least upper bound property of R. Okay, so with that, we'll stop here, and starting the next week, we will start talking about subsequences.